I'm always up for trying new and different products, especially ones that are shimmery. In today's video, I'll create with Doc PH Martin's Iridescent Calligraphy Ink. They're super shimmery, permanent when dry, and because we got a good deal on them, we're able to offer them on introductory sale, priced at 20% off. Links to them and all the other products can be found down below. As I film this in December 2020, there are 24 iridescent colors in the line. They're all water-based, they're intermixable, and they're permanent when dry. You can combine them with other water-based media like liquid watercolors, take out your mad scientist hat, play, and see what happens. These are calligraphic inks, so the shimmer is made of really, really tiny particles, which means you can use them in a dip pen, with a brush, an airbrush, a fountain pen, or even a technical pen, and that really is testimony to how tiny those particles are. Now, I'm not a calligrapher, so my main use is going to be in other ways, more mixed media things, although you can use them with a brush if you like to do brush lettering or you want to make brush stroke patterns. You absolutely can do those things. I'm going to use them to create pretty backgrounds on our black, smooth, and sturdy paper, and I'm also going to do some on the white, too, because there is a significant difference oftentimes in what you see, and we'll talk about that a little bit further on as we go. So techniques to get color on pages or surfaces that I'll demo today include my take on Tim's wrinkle-free, distress wrinkle-free technique. I'm going to drop color on a page and spritz it, and then I'm going to reverse that and start with a wet page and add some color. So we'll play along and do some wonderful things. Now, the mica powder, as I pull these jars out in the front where you can see, first of all, if you look, this color is named copper. You can see the copper mica in the bottom, but you can also see that the liquid is a yellow color. And there are other yellow colors with yellow liquid, but the mica is a different color. So don't be fooled by what you see in the liquid. It's going to change. Now, that mica, as you can see, has settled significantly into the bottom of this bottle. A lot of shaking, I suppose, would eventually get it up and moving, but you can also see that there's some up here in the top. So I'm going to put this back in here for a second, kind of shake some of that off. But really what I want to do, and we'll just push this to one side for now. This will get cleaned up as I shake it some more. But what I want to show you is that I'm going to use this as just an awl. I'm going to use this to stir the mica in the bottom of this bottle to get it up and moving. Because in some cases, especially with copper, there's a ton of it in there. You need to work to get it up off the bottom. There are no beads, no mixing beads in here. So you'll have to do the work manually, something like this. A skewer, even a wooden skewer would work, although a metal one would be better because you're not going to absorb into the skewer itself. Let's just grab a piece of paper towel here to clean that off. So now what I'm going to do is go ahead and shake. Whoops, let's get this lid back on correctly. I'm going to go ahead and shake this. And you can see that there's varying amounts here on the bottom of these others too. So I'm going to pause the video for 1 second. I'm going to get these all stirred up and ready to go. And then I'm going to show you that distress, or my version of that distress wrinkle-free technique for really fun backgrounds. So these are pretty well shaken. You can see that the mica is really mostly up off the bottom of the bottle. Now, one way to really tell is when you shake this, this is going to make some bubbles inside the bottle. If you can see bubbles on the bottom through the glass jar, then you'll be fairly confident that you've got all of that mica up and moving. With that said, it does settle fairly quickly, so I'm just going to give these a shake again. And I'm going to bring in a black and a white smooth and sturdy tag. Now, the colors that I have in front of me are iridescent salmon, iridescent violet, metallic green, and copper. So because these are permanent when they're dry, I can put things like copper and purple or copper and green together and not worry about making mud. I think I'll start with the purple. I'm going to put some out here, and I'm going to spritz. My technique is just a little bit of water. So I'm going to spritz a little bit of water on there. Actually, you know what? Just for fun, let's put some of the pink out too, because pink and purple together are not going to be problematic, and this will make this go in less steps. Just a little bit more water. So there's two techniques. The one is what I call the dipping technique, and then I'll show you the one that is a swirl technique. I'm going to start with the dipping, and you can see that I get these kind of blotchy patterns of color. I'm going to do the same thing with the white version of the smooth and sturdy, and then I'm going to have to take a second to dry this off. Now you can see, first of all, that the colors do look different on white than they do on black, and obviously you get heavier coverage when you've got more of this down. So let me pull this to the side for 1 second, give it a quick dry. Now while this is drying, something worth noting This is a tag I did the other day, and you can see that I've done the swirl technique because that's what this big blobby background is. And then the dappling that you see on there is what happens when you take some of this that's left over like this, and you just go ahead and tap it, and you get that very dappled look with those spots and dots. So now I've used up what's left. I've added another color, and I actually like this a little bit better because it's not so monochromatic, or not that technically the green and the blue are monochromatic, but they're reasonably close. So with that said, this is almost done. I think rather than bring the green in, because you can see how the green and the purple look together here, I think what I'm going to do is just dry this for 1 second, and then I'm going to bring in the copper. So this one is probably good to go, but the first one on the black needs just a moment longer. So while that's doing its thing, I'm going to quickly shake this, and then I'm just going to blot what's left, just for the sake of moving things along. All right, so let's just blot what's left here. Call that close enough. Hit it with the heat tool just for a second. Now, interestingly, you can see that there's pattern on there, right in here, from the pattern that's on the paper towel. Good things happen sometimes when you're messing around. You almost never know what you're going to get. All right. So let's go ahead and put a little bit of the copper out. Now I want this to be more of an accent, so I'm not going to put quite so much. Let's come in, you know what, let's break this up a little bit. Let's come in and do that, and then just go ahead and tap. And you can see that I've got, now I've got my copper accents on there, and I'm a big fan of copper and purple. It's a combination that I really like a lot. And there we go. We've got the accents on there, kind of that dapple look. Now there's less dapple here and more splodgy because I had spread this out a little bit. So for the next one, since I've already got copper down, I'm actually going to go back to the copper again, and I'm going to bring in the pink. And then I'm going to show you how I do the twist technique, which is essentially the same thing. The only difference is that I'm going to twist the tag in the... in the stuff that's puddled here, in the calligraphic ink. All right, so I have another black and another white tag, and this time when I put this down, I'm gonna twist. And you can see that I get a whole completely different effect this way. So if I do it like this, again, you get this very different look by doing that kind of twist. Let's go ahead and do this on the white. Again, a very different look. Now I can come back and I can finish this with spots to make a more dappled look like I did here, which is exactly what happened here, or I could come back and create some more layers. But either way, when you start to play with this stuff, you realize just how marvelous it is, especially since now you're talking about colors that once they're dry are not going to be reactivated, and you can start to take those across the color wheel, those complementary colors, and use them together to get all kinds of really interesting effects. Next, I'm going to bring in a mini ink blending tool. You can see that I've already used it here. I'm going to show you a very simple technique with brush strokes, and then we'll go to the drops. So the first thing to know is that some of these, the mica that's in here, would be considered a duo color. When this is not just a factor of a color on black and a color on white, this is a factor on that duo this is a fact rather of that duo color, because the mica is going to look different on black than it is on white. Some of them, it's just a question of depth of color, but in the case this is iridescent orchid, there is a blue and a pink component to that mica depending on which way the light strikes it. So this was done, these were both done with the same stencil. This is one of Elizabeth St. Hilaire's new ones, and it's named Jump Rope. It's actually a mask, not a stencil, but you get my drift of where I'm going with that. And you can see that I treated it a little bit differently. In both cases, I let the background happen, and I've chosen to go into the areas that are protected by the mask and do a little bit of work in there. Nothing fantastic yet, but everything has to start out simple, so that's fine too. Now, something else to bear in mind when you are working with these, let's bring in, what are we going to bring in here? Let's bring this in. When you work with stencils and something that is as liquid as these iridescent inks are, these calligraphic inks are, there's a certain amount of smudging that's going to happen. It's pretty hard to get perfect stencil images. That's just the nature of the beast. Now on these, I was excruciatingly careful, and you can see that there's still a little creepage under there. It's just part of the process. I was less careful here because I really didn't mind how this looked, and part of the charm of the way that I create is in highlighting all that really imperfect stuff that happens. So I'm going to use this tag, and I'm going to bring in, this is iridescent deep blue. I have a ink blending tool with a fresh foam on it. So what I'm going to do is just put some out. Now bear in mind that because this is fairly liquid, I'm going to have to get some, and I've got a brand new foam, I'm going to have to get some into the foam and just take a minute to kind of let it work its way around. Now I am going to avoid oversaturating the foam to some extent to begin with, because obviously I am going to get better results. So this is another of Elizabeth's new masks. It's named Rosewood, and I'm just going to kind of lay it on here and go ahead and tap through the openings. Now nothing says I have to do the whole thing, and I could stroke with the tool if I wanted. So tapping is going to give me kind of a more mottled look, and pulling the color through and blending in a more circular motion, although not entirely circular, it's going to give me an entirely different look, but you can see what happens. So let's just continue that a little bit. We'll use up what's on here and go ahead and pull this out and then maybe bring some down over here a little bit. And then again, I'm not trying to make great art. I just want to show you how this works, and then we'll call that done. So I've got some pattern going on there that could eventually become pretty much anything. Now, if you rinse this out quickly, you should be able to dry it and reuse it. That's something to keep in mind. All right, let's just clean this up. Actually, you know what? That was dumb. So let's come back to that color. This again is Iridescent Deep Blue, and I'm going to bring in a brush. So one of the things that you can do is use very light brush strokes to create a background pattern. That's what I've done on all of these, and here you can see that I've done it on this tag too. Now it's very, very subtle, but sometimes a background is okay to be really, really subtle. It doesn't have to be super in your face. So I'm going to put some more of the ink out. Now here too, the key is going to be not to oversaturate the bristles of the brush, because I want them. This is kind of an old crappy brush, and you can see that it's fluffed out, but for the purposes of what I'm trying to do, it actually works pretty well. All right, so what I'm going to do is just, now that I've gone in one direction, I'm going to come back and go in another. And I can choose to go as heavy or as light as I want, and I definitely need some more ink at this point, because that is not enough. Now, if I wanted to get a little bit more elaborate, I could certainly make circles or those kind of things. It's just a question of utilizing your brush to create those brush strokes. You could almost make something that looks like plaid if you want. It, again, depends on how you're feeling on any given day. Now on this one, you can see that the vertical is a silver color. I don't remember exactly which one that was. And if you just look, you can see that there are some horizontal ones that I think I did with either this blue or a different blue. So, you know, there's lots of different ways that you can use this. And let's try a circle, just because I've got more out here than what I really need, and see if we can make a really light circle. Now again, I'm encouraging that those bristles to kind of separate. So now these become, you know what this reminds me of? This, when you watch the AccuWeather or the Weather Channel and you see them designate a hurricane or a tropical storm on the map, this kind of reminds me of that. So again, none of this has to be fantastic on its own. What it all does is become part of something bigger. So I'm just going to hit this with a little bit of water. I don't have a bucket of water over to the side, but I'm going to hit that with some water so that the brush doesn't dry out on me and get ruined. But you can see that it works really well. It becomes part of a larger whole, which is, for the most part, what most of us do all of the time anyway. That first layer is usually just a jumping off point. So the last thing I'm going to do is bring in another tag, and we'll start with a dry surface, and that's got something on it already, so let's try the clean side. We'll start with a dry surface, and then we will add some water, and then we'll do it just the opposite. So this color is Iridescent Green. These are all iridescent inks. They do not all have the word iridescent in the name, but some of them do. I didn't name them, I'm just going by what the labels say. All right, so now I'm going to bring in just some plain old water and start to mist. And this is cool because you can really see those drops begin to bloom. Now someplace here I have one that didn't go particularly well. I put down too much ink and not enough water, and I ended up with kind of blobs. But if you like this look, and I love this aura that I'm getting here, what I would do would be to take this to the side and dry it to try to capture that. Now I'm not going to do it now. I am just going to put this off to the side and hope it doesn't change too much in the interim. So this was done this way, and that was done this way too. So now let's try doing just the opposite and starting with a wet tag and drop and see what happens. So again, I'm going to put some water on. Let's use the same color, just so that we're doing an apples to apples comparison. Now the thing with this is if I decide I want to add a little bit more, I certainly can. Now here you get an entirely different look. The way that the bloom happens, you can see that the spread is much bigger. I can't tilt this because if I tilt it, it's going to run, and that's not going to ultimately get me where I need to be. But if I bring this one back in, and again, I just want to flatten this a little bit and get rid of some of this excess water, you can see that there's definitely a difference in the way that the bloom happens. So it really becomes a matter of experimentation and preference. Which do you like, and which do you maybe like better? And that's sort of the path that you go through. So here you go. These are Doc P.H. Martin's Iridescent Calligraphic Inks, and they're on introductory sale priced at 20% off.